break out. Break our walls down. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down.
Welcome. This is the Crossing Service, the contemporary worship at St. Philip Lutheran Church here in Raleigh, North Carolina. We're so happy that you joined us this morning. We are following the CDC guidelines, so anyone in person is asked to wear a mask, except if you've got a speaking or singing part. If you don't feel well or haven't or been exposed to somebody in the last 14 days, we do ask you to stay home. If you have been on campus within 14 days and you do have symptoms or know that you have been in contact with somebody, we also ask you to contact the office with that information. During the sharing of peace today, during that time, be aware of what your fellow worshiper may be comfortable with. We have fist bumps, elbow bumps. You can just wish them peace. So do bear the feelings of your fellow worshipers at that time. Okay, also, yesterday we had a great brown bag ministry, and it was also the diaper delivery day, so we want to thank all of those that come out for that. Your next opportunity for that will be Saturday, September 11th, which just so happens to fall on the God's Work Our Hands Day weekend. So if Sunday is not a day that works for you, and many of us sometimes that happens, consider Saturday and come at 10 o'clock brown bag ministry.
And even if it does work for you, still come at 10 o'clock on Saturday.
This is also true, right. And then on Sunday, there will be one service at 10 o'clock for the God's Work Our Hands. There is an RSV on the website. They would like to know how many to plan for. They have some service projects lined up, plus the meal afterwards. So if you're planning on being there to partake in any of this, please RSVP to that. Let's see, there's also coming up in 3 weeks now, I guess, Pastor Tim will be leading a Bible study on the book of Acts starting on Wednesday, September 15th. That will be at 10:30 here in the music room, and we've also planned that that will be streamed via Zoom, so more details to follow on that. And that is all I have, unless anybody else has anything. Oh, Pastor has a couple announcements, sure enough. Of course.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So, as Kathy said, we do have only one service on God's Work Our Hands Sunday. That, by the way, is a national day of service for all of our ELCA congregations across the nation. That one worship service will be at 10 a.m. You know, we normally have a 9 a.m. crossing service, 11 a.m. traditional, so we split the difference. The one worship will be at 10 a.m. That will be followed by a meal, and the service opportunities thereafter will be four or five different opportunities. They will all take place here on our campus. You can see more details about that in the bulletin. Also, please dress casually and comfortably on that day in particular. There will be no Saints and Sinners for the month of September. Again, no Saints and Sinners meeting for the month of September. Please stay tuned to see if we will have that in October or not. Also, on Saturday, September 25th, the Stewardship Committee is sponsoring here an estate planning, which will be done by Thrivent. We want as many people as possible to come out to learn how to effectively give your estate when that time comes to your spouse or your children or charities or whatever. Please see the bulletin for more details, and there's a sign-up link for that as well. But we are really trying to drum up support for that event. And finally, we got our parking lot repainted and resealed and redone. So it looks wonderful out there, and I'd just like to pause a minute to praise God and to thank God for the resources at this church necessary for all of our capital improvements as of late. So our parking lot is new, our church roof is new, the ceiling here in Kepley is new, this altar is new, this pulpit will soon be new, and all of that is due to the resources that God has given us and that we have responded with faithfully ourselves to give to our congregation. So we thank God and we thank all of you for that. Amen.
Thank you. Okay, if you'd please rise and join me for the call to worship. Most merciful God, we admit that we are prone to sin and we need your help to free us. Every day of our lives, we sin against you with our actions and our inability to act. With our hurtful words or our painful silence, sin consumes our lives. We have held back from loving you fully. We have focused on loving ourselves. And with that, we have left out, have not reached out to our neighbors. Your Son sacrificed and died for us. Show us your mercy, forgive our sins, refresh our hearts, and guide us through our days. We love you and want to be like you. We are thankful for your grace so that our sins do not permanently separate us from you. Amen.
We are in need of a Savior, in need of mercy. And God provided Jesus, who loves us so much that he died for us. Through Jesus' love, God has forgiven all our sins.
Amen. Amen.
God, Father, in community.
We look to God for guidance, forgiveness, and love.
As God calls us together as a community,
we look to each other
for companionship, forgiveness, and love. Let us pass the peace of God and greet each other in community. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you, Kathy.
And peace to those online. Lord God, friend of those in need, your Son Jesus has untied our burdens and healed our spirits. We lift up the prayers of our hearts for those still burdened, those seeking healing, those in need within the church and the world. You know what and who is on our hearts better than we do. Please hear those prayers now spoken silently or aloud. Together, loving God, open our ears to hear your word and draw us closer to you. Guide our focus from false idols to you and your call for each of us, that the whole world may be one with you as you are one with us, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Stand for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel today comes from the gospel of Mark, the 7th chapter. Now, when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who have come from Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all of the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes ask him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far off from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." Then he called the crowd together and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile. But the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person. The Gospel of the Lord for the people of God.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Lord, let our hearts not be far from you. Help us reach out to our neighbor, even when we are busy or tired. Let us tear down walls when we'd rather let them stand. Stretch us, please. Whether we are visiting a prisoner, offering a smile, feeding the hungry, be within us so that whatever we do with your love. Let the world know we are your disciples, not because our hands are clean, but they are soiled with the mark of your people. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My sermon text for today is the gospel lesson, Mark chapter 7. It's kind of choppy, verses 1 through 8, 14 through 15, and 21 through 23. My sermon title for this morning is The Heart of the Matter. The Heart of the Matter. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we are mindful this morning of your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your beneficence. We thank you, Lord, for creating this new day, which we have never seen before, and waking us up in our right minds to behold the beauty of your creation. We thank you for the gift of each other, this assembly of saints, both in person and online. We thank you for this opportunity to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we ask that as your word goes forth today, as always, that it might be for the salvation of souls, the transformation of lives, the edification of all hearers, the furtherance of your kingdom, and ultimately the glory of your name. We are mindful this hour of those in the path of Hurricane Ida. We pray that you might lessen the power and impact of that storm, that you would protect lives and property. We are also mindful of the people and the situation in Afghanistan. We ask that all those who need to and are able to get out would be able to do so. We pray for a conviction of heart for the new rulers of that land, that you might soften their hearts, their minds, their stances, so that justice, righteousness, and peace would come to that nation. Bless and protect all those who live there. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We find ourselves once again back in Mark's gospel this morning after a rather lengthy sojourn in not only John's gospel, but in chapter 6 for many weeks. Mark is believed to be the earliest written of the four gospels. Sometime in the late AD 60s, by one John Mark, a cousin of Barnabas and a traveling companion of the Apostle Paul, as a summary of Peter's preaching while both of them were in Rome. Mark portrays Jesus as the Messiah, the Son of God, who is almost constantly active in his ministry, most of which is as a powerful exorcist, healer, and miracle worker. The text we have before us this morning often falls under the heading, The Traditions of the Elders, and encapsulate Jesus' brewing controversy with the religious leaders of his day, normally referred to as Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, and elders. Should you be interested, there is a parallel text that is another account of this same episode by another author in Matthew chapter 15, verses 1 through 20. They are largely the same in this instance, the only variance being some additional animosity towards the Pharisees in Matthew's account. There is a brewing controversy in Jesus' life and ministry with those who would shortly become his only real enemies, namely the religious leaders and authorities of his day. And the controversy surrounds understandings and interpretations of God's law as found in Scripture, specifically what we Christians now call the Old Testament. Jesus, you may recall, seemed to play footloose and fancy-free with the laws of God as handed down from God to Moses and the people of Israel generations earlier. He certainly had his own take on things. Oftentimes, he seemed to heighten the law to absurd, preposterous levels, and at other times, he seemed to discard it or ignore it entirely. Most often, however, it was a matter of emphasis, priority, and interpretation. Jesus caused contention, you may remember, by healing or curing people on the Sabbath day, an act of love in itself, but one which violated God's prohibition of work on that one day of the week, as understood by most of his own people, the Jews. Jesus further invited opposition by accepting, receiving, and actually dining with quote-unquote sinners, tax collectors, and prostitutes, one whom the law deemed unclean and outcast by their dubious behaviors. Here today, the issue begins with ritual purity, that is, the washing and cleansing of hands and vessels, before progressing towards food itself, which occurs in the left out verses 17 through 19. And the issue is which things are deemed clean and therefore allowed versus unclean and therefore prohibited, most of which can be found in the book of Leviticus. Jesus, at first blush, appears to be lax about these particular rules and rituals as he dispenses with the ceremonial washing of hands and vessels along with the dietary prohibitions of the Torah, the laws of Moses. So to be fair to the Pharisees and the scribes here, they are not simply making this stuff up from scratch, out of thin air, or from left field. No, rather they could cite you chapter and verse, as it were, from Leviticus and parts of Deuteronomy to back their claims. Here again, it undoubtedly comes down to a matter of emphasis, what legal scholars might term original intent, and what many of us commonly understand as the letter of the law versus the spirit of the law. You can tell from the text itself that the Pharisees, scribes, and people's particular understanding and interpretations of these laws has stood the test of time and dates back generations, as both verses 3 and 5 refer to them as the tradition of the elders. You can just as easily detect Jesus' frustration and impatience with what he considers their deviation from the original intent of that law when he says in verse number 8, "You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." In verse 9, "You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to keep your tradition." And in verse 13, which we did not read, "Thus making void the word of God through your tradition, which you have handed on." Jesus' initial charge against them is that of hypocrisy, as he quotes from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 29, verse 13, in case you're interested. "This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines." Herein, Jesus is contrasting the word or the commandment of God, which he holds paramount, with human tradition, which at least here he seems to denigrate. It begs the question then, what human traditions do we hold steadfast and reverently, which at best obscure the word of God, or at worst contradict it? That's a biting indictment, isn't it? I don't know about you, my friends, but that always arrests me. The contemporary English version translates here, "All of you praise me with your words, but you never really think about me." While the Message Remix version reads here, "These people make a big show of saying the right things, but their heart is not in it. They act like they are worshiping me, but they don't really mean it. They just use me as a cover." I doubt any among us today are so holy and pious as to have these words not prick our conscience. Jesus more specifically explicates his case in verses 14 and 15 herein by laying out the general principle he is applying. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. The disciples in Mark are often portrayed as obtuse, thick-headed, not quite getting it, which I submit is good news for us. And so Jesus further explains his rationale in the remaining verses of verses 17 through 23, part of which is omitted from our reading today. "Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from the outside cannot defile, since it enters not into the heart but rather into the stomach and so goes out the bowels? Thus he declared all foods clean. Rather, he says, it is what comes out of a person that defiles. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, that is financial or monetary greed, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, that is sexually lewd or lustful behavior, envy, slander, pride, and folly, that is foolishness. All of these evil things come from within, and they are what defile a person." A similar list of works of the flesh can be found in Galatians chapter 5, conveniently contrasted with the fruit of the Spirit, should you be interested in another similar moral or ethical map to follow. If all of us are honest with ourselves, I think much of that list hits far closer to home than perhaps we'd like to admit. The rather obvious move Jesus is making here is very appealing and commonsensical at the same time that it is unnerving or frightening. He is essentially moving from outer to inner, from actions and rituals to thoughts and intentions, from what can be seen and detected by others to what is less obvious. Contrary to our human proclivity to put the cart before the horse, Jesus is trying to reinstate the primacy of the horse. I purchased a plaque years ago which hangs in my home office and reads simply, "Thoughts become words, words become actions, actions become character, character is everything." Again, thoughts become words, words become actions, actions become character, character is everything. Jesus seems to be saying something similar here and in many other places of Scripture, that character is everything. And that your character is based on your actions, but it doesn't stop there. Your actions are based on your words, and your words are based on your thoughts. To me, that is both appealing and logical, and yet also unnerving and frightening. For I think most of us would agree that it's perhaps easier to regulate and to tame our actions, less so our words, and even less so our thoughts. Who can effectively regulate, train, and discipline his or her thoughts, as Jesus seems to be requesting, if not demanding, in this text? The Apostle Paul gives some practical advice on this front towards the very end of his epistle or letter to the Philippians when he counsels, "Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worship worthy of praise, think about those things." I suspect all of us would agree with that sentiment and would do our best to accommodate it, but it's still much easier said than done, easier to attempt than accomplish. The problem and the solution are really one and the same in this text. There is one concept which is paramount in this text and upon which, therefore, everything else hangs. Verse number 6, "This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." Verse number 19, which again was left out, "Whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile, since it enters not the heart, but the stomach, and so passes on." Verse 21, "For it is from within, from the human hearts, that evil intentions come." The heart is a funny thing, my friends. It is both the problem and the solution. It is both the source of much evil and the seat of much love, affection, and compassion. But who can control it? Who can regulate it? Who can direct it in the right way? Think for a minute about the occurrences of heart in Scripture, my friends. Do you know what the very first instance is? Genesis 6, just prior to the flood. "The Lord saw that the wickedness of humankind was great in the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of their hearts was only evil continually. The Lord was sorry that he had made humankind on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart." Do you remember why Pharaoh refused to let the Hebrew slaves go free in Egypt back in the book of Exodus? What was hardened? His heart. God refuses to anoint any of the tall and handsome sons of Jesse king over Israel until the ruddy-complexioned young boy David comes in. Reason given? Because humankind looks on the outward appearance while God looks on the heart. King David is later exalted as a man after God's own heart. The psalmist once cried out in lament and repentance, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. In the Beatitudes, Jesus blessed those who are pure in heart, saying that they shall see God. God promises his people in Ezekiel 36, a new heart I will give you. I will take out of you your heart of stone, and I will give you a heart of flesh so that you may be my people, and I will be your God. And perhaps my favorite, because it is such an obscure and unknown verse, yet so powerful, 1 John 3 and verse 20. 1 John 3 and verse 20. We reassure our hearts before God, because whenever our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts. We assure our hearts before God, because whenever our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts. So our hearts are not ultimate, you see. They are penultimate. God's character of grace and mercy and forgiveness is what is ultimate. So apply that plaque not to you, but to God. Thoughts become words. Words become actions. Actions become character. Character is everything. God's character is based on his actions, which are based on his words, which are based on his thoughts, and God's thoughts towards you are loving. They are merciful. They are accepting. They are embracing. And that makes all the difference in the world. That is the source of your heart's transformation. My friends, as God extends grace and mercy to you, he forgives you all of your sins because of his Son, Jesus Christ. And as his grace and mercy and forgiveness surround you and envelop you, you will find your character being transformed. It will be transformed because your actions are being transformed, your words are being transformed, and your thoughts are being transformed. The thoughts of your heart are no longer only evil continually, as Genesis said. Your heart is being softened. Your thoughts are becoming more charitable. Your words kinder and gentler. Your actions more compassionate and just. And your character is becoming holier and possessing integrity. Even if your heart has been hardened and it convicts you, God is greater than your heart. God knows all things. He loves you unconditionally and eternally. He forgives you not just some of your sins, but all of your sins. He transforms your life. He is forming you into the image of his Son, Jesus Christ, even as we speak. Your heart is increasingly becoming a heart of love. A heart of love for God and a heart of love for your neighbor. That's why you don't have to be concerned with Mark chapter 7 anymore. You need not worry about hand washing, vessel washing, or dietary restrictions, except perhaps for reasons of physical health and hygiene, but not for holiness. For according to Romans 13, love is the fulfilling of the law. All the commandments of God are summed up in this one sentence, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Go forth knowing that Jesus has given you a new heart this day, a new mind, with new thoughts, a new capability and capacity for love. As Paul told the Corinthians, no eye has seen, nor ear has heard, nor heart has conceived what God has in store for those who love him. You can't even imagine what the consequences of your new heart are about to be. The heart of the matter. The heart of the matter. Amen.
Amen. We thank you for your support of the mission and ministry here at St. Philip. You can make an offering online, or there is an offering plate at the back of the sanctuary if you are here in person. Thank you.
Thank you. fighting, you're finding the risen King. Come on and let the light in. Your love changes everything. Your love, your love, your love changes everything. Your love, your love, your love changes everything. None can overcome when death has lost its sting. Your love, your love, your love. Oh, 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 I will fear no evil. You'll never let me go. You'll never let me go. Come out into the waters. Come let the broken sing. Come all your sons and daughters. His love changes everything. Come when the fear is fighting. Find in the risen King. Come on and let the your love, your love, your love changes everything. Your love, your love, your love changes everything. Your love, your love, your love changes everything.
Please stand and please join us as we profess our faith in song.
In this time of desperation, we know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you helped us. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and it's coming back again. We believe. Let our faith be more than ever, greater than the songs we sing. In our weakness and temptation, we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. sing, let the church live loud, and God will say, we believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil, now we know your love will never fail, we believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And he's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. We believe. We believe.
Let the church say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good job, band. Good job in leading us in songs of praise and worship, and fittingly today, of love. We celebrate together now the Lord's Supper, the feast of Holy Communion. Scripture tells us that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Now we pray together as Jesus asks us. Our Father,
our Mother,
who art in heaven,
who are in all the earth,
hallowed be thy name,
holy is your truth,
thy kingdom come,
may your wisdom come,
thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven,
your circle be one, uniting heaven and earth.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us today a nurturing spirit.
And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Heal through us as we ourselves are healed.
Lead us not into temptation. Lead us into fullness of life. But deliver us from evil
and liberate all that is good.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
For the wisdom, presence, and the goodness are yours, now and forever. Amen. Come forward now to receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of all your sins and eternal life. We ask that you maintain social distance by family units as you approach the altar.
wonder of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God, sing with me, how great.
Receive now our post-communal blessing. Now may the eating of Christ's body and the drinking of his blood strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Jesus, no words can express our gratitude and amazement that you should die for us. How amazing is it that each of our lives is so valuable to you that you would lay down yours to reach us. May the bread and wine remain with us as we seek to take your message of love and grace out into this world. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We believe that your grace is stronger than all our faults and failures. We believe that your love is deeper than our hearts could fathom. We believe that with you, Jesus, we could change the world. Thank you.
it's all a dream they've made. Keep on moving, though the waters stay raging. In this maze, you can lose your way, your way. It might drive you crazy, but don't let it phase you. No way, no way. Sometimes in my tears I drown, but I never let it get me down. So when negativity surrounds, I know someday it'll all turn around. Because all my life I've been waiting for, I've been praying for the people to say that we don't want to fight no more. There'll be no more wars, and our children will play. One day, one day, one day. One day, one day, one day.
Then it's always changed, treat people the same. Stop with the violence, done with the hate. When they will all be free, and proud to be under the same sun, singing songs of freedom like one day, one day, one day. One day, one day, one day. All my life I've been waiting for, I've been praying for the people to say that we don't want to fight no more. There'll be no more wars, and our children will play. One day, one day, one day. One day, one day, one day.
Go in peace and love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.